I wasn't even born when the Battle of Britain raged over Kent. I can only imagine the sounds of battle and the vapour trails of stricken aircraft crisscrossing the sky as an ever-shrinking band of young pilots defended this country from invasion against overwhelming odds.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
The closest I've ever come to committing an act of bravery was back in 2006 in Australia with a bunch of celebrities. It was terrifying, but I can't claim to know anything of the terror those pilots must have experienced. On my return from the jungle, I sponsored a name on the Battle of Britain Memorial at Capel the Fern near Folkestone. I was intrigued by all the foreign names listed here, especially the French pilots. There are 13 French names on this wall of remembrance, and because of my French ancestry, I asked to sponsor a French pilot, and the name I was given was that of René Mouchotte. René was a Spitfire ace who was killed in battle at the age of 29, and who left behind plenty of evidence of his short but dramatic life and a mystery to solve in death. The man who chose this name for me was Group Captain Patrick Tootle of the Battle of Britain Memorial Trust, and he explained if it hadn't been for my French connection, he could very easily have chosen an American or a New Zealander or any of a dozen or so other nationalities who made up Churchill's famous few.
There are several nations, you know, from occupied Europe, the Commonwealth, and New Zealanders were a large contingent, Australians, Canadians, Americans who had to become Canadians to fight or else they would have been arrested back home.
Really?
Yes, they crossed the border and became Canadians to join the Battle of Britain. And of course the Free French, many of them escaping to North Africa and then coming through Gibraltar back to Britain.
René was one of those Free French pilots, and I wanted to know more about him, his life before the war, how he ended up fighting here with the RAF, and how he died. I wanted to know the whole story.
But I'd no idea what an extraordinary story it was, and where that story would take me.
As soon as I started to research the name René Mouchotte, I discovered he'd kept diaries which were published after the war, and I even found him in an old newsreel from 1943.
Who shot first of you two?
Well, geez, I don't know.
This was René enjoying his own brief taste of celebrity as one of two pilots who shared the credit for shooting down Biggin Hill's 1,000th enemy plane.
Well, boys, what about it, eh?
That's okay.
So the Maurice Canadian and Frenchman share the credit and the sweepstake.
The 1,000th shot down plane was such a big deal at Biggin Hill that many airmen had refused to take leave so they could be around to see it. And as Wing Commander Andy Simpson told me, this bumped up the sweepstake prize money to a tidy sum for 1943.
Apparently the winner of the sweepstake was going to get £150, which was not an insubstantial sum at the time, and the pilot who got the 1,000th was going to get 300. So of course what actually happened was that the two pilots shared it.
René shared his portion of the prize money with his crew, and they all got a chance to celebrate at a huge party at the Grosvenor House Hotel in London.
Commodore René, who shared the 1,000th Hun, was there.
A rare opportunity to enjoy some rest and relaxation away from the war.
When the end of the evening came, a delegation of taxi drivers appeared to offer their services to those going home, any distance and for nothing. This merited considerable applause and provided a grand note upon which to end a highly successful evening.
In his 3 years of action with the RAF, René completed more than 380 sorties. He flew from bases all over the country, but is best remembered here at Biggin Hill, where he became the first Frenchman to lead an RAF squadron. He even had a local street named after him, where servicemen from all the forces still live today, including Lieutenant Colonel Sebastian Pollington.
We all know of the significance of Mouchotte, and indeed other famous airmen whose roads here at the at Biggin Hill Patch are named after. But Mouchotte in particular, because it's the biggest road on the patch, and the significance of him is not lost on the residents here. And there's a book that goes round the patch, and everybody who's read it signs it and passes it on to the next guy.
The book is a collection of René's war diaries, his first-hand account of life as an RAF pilot. Much more than just a description of missions and sorties, these are personal notes about fear, fatigue, blackouts in the air, anger at bureaucracy, and what it feels like to see your friends die in battle.
We had been flying for over an hour when I suddenly saw the fatal white cloud, which indicates complete engine failure. As we made for the coast, I advised him to bail out. My poor old Charles, if only you had listened to me. When we were at 50 feet, he straightened his plane out. Then, with a savagely swift movement, the plane lurched to starboard, skimmed the sea, turned over, and vanished in less than a second.
It is it's a fantastic series of diaries and flying logs, this, and it is well worth a read. And the romance behind these stories of these airmen is fabulous.
What really comes across from the diaries is René's determination to fight to liberate France. At the Battle of Britain, René was one of 13 free French pilots who had escaped to England after France surrendered to the Nazis. According to historian Professor Mark Connolly, René risked his life just to get here in 1940 when he escaped from a surrendered French airfield in Africa, stole a plane and flew it to Gibraltar.
That was a massive act of bravery and daring in its own right, because Gibraltar was on red alert, so anything flying across its airspace, they could have had the whole of the anti-aircraft defences open up on them. And of course, if they'd have strayed into Franco's airspace, they would have found things very nasty for them. So the very start of their journey was fraught, was almost a mini battle in its own right, even before they got to Britain.
Cheating death was a way of life for pilots like René. At the Battle of Britain, they were outgunned and outnumbered, but it was a battle they had to win no matter what. Defeat would have seen Britain invaded and overcome and left most of Europe under Hitler's control.
It would have opened up the way for the Nazis to dominate the entire seaboard of the Eastern Atlantic, possibly use the British fleet to put pressure on the Americans. And we might have seen the Second World War pan out in a very different way. It is a moment where history is shaped and made by the few, as Winston Churchill called them.
René survived the Battle of Britain and many other adventures, but almost inevitably his time came on the 27th of August 1943. His death, shortly after this photograph was taken, was shrouded in confusion and mystery for several years. Something that would have unexpected consequences for me as my journey unfolded. Paris was René's hometown. I wanted to know more about his life before the war and to see if any of his relatives had survived. So I decided to visit the places where he grew up and the streets he walked. René came from a well-to-do family. He was born here almost a century ago in the summer of 1914. The Mouchottes ran a successful distillery business, and René grew up in this grand Parisian villa. Today, it's an apartment building with no trace of his family here anymore. So my only option was to leave a note at the Mouchotte tomb at the Pére Lachaise Cemetery in the hope that someone with a connection to René would find it. Incredibly, 4 months later, the note was found by René's sister, Jacqueline, who instructed her son-in-law, Hubert Delisle, to contact me.
Well, my mother-in-law found the letter in late October, beginning of November, when she naturally, every year, went to put flowers on the tomb. Mm-hmm. And she called me and she said, there's this letter, it's in French and English. Somebody wants to make a recording, photographs or on the life of René Mouchotte. Mm-hmm. And she was slightly reticent at first.
I don't know.
Until I discovered it was you, Jan Leeming, on your email, managed to contact you, and then that was it.
Jacqueline agreed to see me, and we met on her 101st birthday. We looked at photos of her with René when they were children, and the news footage of her brother from the war, footage she'd never seen before. She had fond memories of him as a boy who was always kind and smiling.
Toujours de très bons souvenirs. C'est un garçon qui était toujours aimable, toujours souriant, très gai.
With tears in her eyes, she said it was wonderful to see her brother as she remembered him 70 years ago when he set off for war. Although René is remembered and honoured in France, I was astonished to discover that the Mouchotte family had never received his Battle of Britain medals. I decided to find out why, and my search took me north to Belgium and the stretch of coast where René died.
On the 3rd of September 1943, a body in RAF uniform was found on the beach here at West Ender.
The man had been dead for a week. He'd been shot down somewhere over the English Channel, returning from a raid over the Pas-de-Calais. According to the documentation recovered from the body, his name was René Martin, and he was a French-Canadian.
And this is where the body was laid to rest, in the Field of Honour at Middlekirk Cemetery, in grave number 87.
But the body had fake identification. It was, in fact, René Mouchotte. He carried fake ID because he was a free French pilot. The wartime Vichy government had given orders to execute anyone from France who'd chosen to fight against the Nazis. So, to protect himself and his family in France, René kept the fake ID of a French Canadian. I met up with local archivist Simon Vosters at the Middlekirk Museum to find out how René's real identity was eventually discovered, thanks to detailed records made at the time.
They don't only talk about his height, but also his color hair, the fact that certain teeth were missing. But in general, his body was still in a good shape.
René probably died of exposure after crashing into the sea and washed up in Belgium a week later.
There's something strange about his wristwatch. It had stopped the day they had found the body, which is a bit strange because you would suspect that the moment he crashed into the sea, the watch would have stopped. But when they made the research, they discovered that it had stopped just, I think, shortly after they found the body on the beach. Is it coincidence? I don't know, but yeah.
6 years later, in 1949, the post-mortem report was re-examined, and it was discovered that a small piece of clothing on the body bore the name René Mouchotte. So the body was exhumed and transported to Paris to be reburied with the correct name on the grave.
It was important for the family afterwards to see who was actually found on Middlekirk soil, and especially, well, this is actually proven with the René Mouchotte case, that if he didn't do it properly, he would have troubles when the war would end.
Now I knew the full story of the confusion over René's death and a possible reason as to why his medals were never presented to his family, but that was something I could put right. I contacted the Allied Air Force's museum in York, and with their help I was able to go back to Paris last summer and finally present Jacqueline and her family with her brother's Battle of Britain medals.
Merci beaucoup, madame. Il y en a trois. Que c'est joli.
She was not in good health at the time, but delighted to receive them. She died just 3 weeks later. Jacqueline was buried here at Pere Lachaise, in the family tomb where René's body was eventually laid to rest 6 years after his death.
The flowers look lovely. Thank you, Jan.
No, it's my pleasure. It was a great pleasure to meet, to meet all of you, but to meet your mother, that was really very special.
Well, it's a high moment in her life, towards the end of her life, to meet you and the medals and to be presented. We were all thrilled to be there. On était tous contents.
Tous contents.
De accueillir Jeanne et les médailles autour d'elle.
Oh. Et pour maman, une jeune femme aussi charmante.
Oh, and meeting you. Such a charming young person, she said.
I think she needed her eyes tested.
No. Her eyes were much better than all of us.
My search for René and his family has taken up much of my life since 2007. But with the help of a great many people, I've finally been able to complete his story.
So my journey has ended where it began. And after 5 years of searching, René Mouchotte is no longer just a name engraved on a wall.